And now to our truly amazing keynote speaker. We've all watched lots of movies about robots and computers that think and feel and fall in love. But there's probably no one in the world who's thinking more profoundly about these possibilities and doing more to realize their potential than Professor Hod Lipson. Dr. Lipson, who is Columbia University's James and Sally Scapa Professor of Innovation, I like that, Professor of Innovation, also directs the university's Creative Machines Lab. Dr. Lipson calls himself a roboticist and a mechanical engineer, but those terms hardly begin to describe the range of his work. To give you just a few examples, Dr. Lipson and his students have been the pioneers and have been pioneers in the fields of multi-material printing and bioprinting, and more recently, food printing, which I'd love to learn more about later. Dr. Lipson created a program called Eureka that in a single day came up with a mathematical representation of Newton's second law and has since described the behavior of various chemical compounds in oxygen-deprived yeast cells. Dr. Lipson is also the co-founder of four different companies and his unforgettable 2007 TED Talk on self-aware machines, including one that teaches itself to walk, are among the most universally watched lectures ever given on artificial intelligence. Obviously, I could go on, but fortunately for all of us, I don't have to. Please welcome the innovation man himself, Professor Hod Lipson.
Artificial intelligence is one of these technologies that sort of, they start slowly, they disappoint us, they underperform us, but then something happens and they exceed our expectations and we're not ready. And we are at this point today. So if you look at what artificial intelligence can do, you'll hear a few smart people tell you AI is the most dangerous thing we've ever invented. It's going to take over the world. That's what Hollywood says as well. At the same time, you have a lot of smart people who'll tell you AI is nothing but spreadsheets and analytics. Yes, they get better with time, but they're not going to take over the world soon, and it's just all hype. So what is it? Is it hype or is it going to take over the world? That's the question we're all struggling with. And the reality is that AI doesn't look like either of these things. AI in reality looks like this, like nothing. All right, you cannot see it, you cannot touch it, you cannot smell it. It is like air, it is everywhere. It worms its way into everything we do. It's predicting the stock market, it's governing our economy, it's predicting the weather, it's predicting what song you're gonna listen to, what product you're gonna buy, what link you're gonna click on. It's listening to you. It's talking to you. And this is the challenge with artificial intelligence. It is everything and nothing at the same time. It doesn't matter if you're studying engineering or journalism or education. You need to understand how artificial intelligence will shape our future world and creates opportunities for you as well as creates various risks and hazards. We've had artificial intelligence for decades. So what has changed? So there's really two ways in which artificial intelligence systems are built. The first one is what we call rule-based AI, and that's the majority of AI systems out there. And that's where you have you hire an expert in some topic, an expert programmer, and they write rules, conditional rules, if then else, that explain to a computer how to do something. And computer can execute that very quickly in a gazillion transactions. I'd say 99% of AI systems out there are based on these rules. But the challenge is that to make a rule-based system, you have to have an expert that will tell you what the rules are. And experts, as we know, are slow, expensive, and wrong. So what do we do without experts? The alternative is what we call machine learning, data-driven AI, AI that's based on examples. You don't tell the computer what to do, you show it. You don't tell the computer what the criteria for a fraudulent transaction is, you give it examples of a few dozen. And the computer can calculate the odds of these things happening again. We call this conditional probabilities. Now, we humans, we don't like probabilities. We have no intuition about statistics. We hate it. But computers love it. From supermarket to tic-tac-toe to driving a car can be done with this incredibly powerful single idea about learning statistics automatically. But here's a frustrating thing. Both of these approaches to AI existed for 50 years. So why did it take so long? 1956, IBM demonstrates a computer that can beat the world champion in checkers. Incredible accomplishment. The New York Times writes, the world is over. Machines can learn. But the next thing that happened is amazing. Experts in the AI academia swoop in and kill the project. Why? They say, this is interesting but impractical. Where are you going to get data? How are you going to store data? Where are you going to transmit this data? This will never work. It is an infertile idea. Intelligent systems based on rules and logic and reasoning. What we like to think is intelligence. But there's another kind of intelligence out there, intelligence based on data. And I like to, the equivalent of data-driven AI is like intelligence based on intuition, on experience. It's a different kind of intelligence that's maybe infrequently more powerful. And this is what is happening today, is that transition of rules better than data is beginning to change because we have more data. Up until a few years ago, most of that data, with all the machine learning and all the computing power, all of that data was useless. We call that unstructured data. Nobody with all the data and all the computing power could write software that would tell the difference between a cat and a dog. The needle is not moving on this problem of perception. If there's one term you have to remember in AI, is deep learning. Car that can tell the difference not just between what's a car and not a car, but what kind of car it is. It is just because it was given examples of these things to learn from. So when you think about how you're going to innovate in this space and what the opportunities are, remember that the technology itself is free as a commodity, is universal. The talent is easily obtainable. Computing power is free. It's what you do with this technology and what data you use to train your system. That's where the innovation is happening. What can it track when it can see in colors we cannot see and hear in frequencies we cannot hear? We will not have words to describe what it can understand. We won't have imagination to think about what it can think about. The most powerful exponential of them all and the most overlooked, and that is the cloud. We use the cloud all the time, but the cloud means something else for AI. It means AI teaching other AI. It gets even more powerful when you have an adversarial relationship between AIs. You want an AI that plays chess? You have it play against another AI that plays chess. They will generate their own fuel. And that is an incredibly powerful thing. AI moves forward in waves. Each wave brings a capability that was thought impossible in the previous waves. We're now in the third wave, in the middle. So what's going to happen next? The first wave was rule-based AI. I talked about that disappointing phase, 50 years of rule-based and didn't take us anywhere. Then in the 90s, we started with predictive analytics, the first generation of machine learning that the stock market uses, Wall Street, that we use to predict, that works with any tabulated data, like stock data, or we can use it to predict how many cucumbers we're going to sell next month. This is important stuff, but it's not the future. The third wave of AI, in which we are today, is the wave of cognitive computing. For the first time in history, we have machines that can understand images, video, text, audio, things that we thought impossible just 5 years ago. But one area that is actually difficult for AI is having a conversation. When you think about the future of education, if it involves talking to people in a conversation, there's no AI on the planet that is even close to doing this. Yes, you can replace professors in academia because we only talk one way, and we're going to place us with a video, but anything early childhood education that involves having a conversation is no AI is even close to doing that. And not only is it not close, we have no clue how to do it. But we humans, we have a different kind of intelligence. We can generate new things. We can be creative. Creativity is at the crosshair of AI. Because AI can create things, not just images like I showed you, but physical things. This is the biggest race in AI right now, is who can build the AI that can create the next AI. So we lump all these big words, emotions and free will under this word sentience. Can machines be sentient? Many people think that the answer is no. I think the answer is yes, and it will happen. And it will happen when all this incredible capability is turned inside and the AI begins to think about itself, rather than the world. So the big questions are ethical? Should we do this? How far can we keep up with this? Can ethics keep pace with this? Can regulators keep pace with this? Where are we going? A lot of people are terrified that we can use this technology to do bad things, and we can, and some people will. But I argue that by and far, we will use this technology to do good things. So the question is for you, how are you going to use this technology to make sure that we use it in the right way? Because we are at an incredible transition point, a point that we will never look back, and the future will be nothing short of amazing. Thank you.